future. I'll be the future. Hello, friends. Welcome to the Youth Ministry 101 podcast, a place where you can learn tips, tricks, and hear stories to help reach youth in your life, parish, and youth group. Feel free to take a drink.
Did you hear it?
I heard it a little bit.
I rotated. Okay. And then
you're like, trying to get the product placement going. You're like,
oh, I can't recreate the
sound. Take it.
Yeah, no. This is gold.
This is
happening. This is live.
Okay.
I don't remember what I was saying before, but welcome to the podcast, tips everybody. Tricks. Tips and tricks. Mm. Oh, to reach youth in your life, parish, and youth group. Mm. To share in the love and joy of Jesus Christ and His church. That's what our goal is. We want people to share in the love and joy of Christ and His church. My name is Matthew, for those of you who don't already know. And I'm joined here by, introduce yourself and your favorite toothbrush color.
Oh. Caught me off guard already. Okay.
My name's Josh.
The camera literally went to me.
You guys are so photogenic. You guys are so photogenic.
Don't like, hit the table.
I forgot to mention
look
that.
At these
normally, people like are like afraid to look at the camera.
Oh,
they're like,
really?
Kind of like avoid. You guys are just like straight. Like, hey.
This is my big break. Okay. My name is
Josh.
Stop. My name is Josh. My name is Faith. My favorite toothbrush color. Let's say minty green because it matches the color of my toothpaste.
Oh, how do you know when to stop then? That's a good question. It all looks like a toothpaste. What if you like brush your teeth with the wrong end?
Then that's a me problem. That's a learning experience and I won't ever do it again. That's how wisdom happens, by mistakes first.
You know we're here too, right?
No, I think I'm avoiding this side because I keep looking at it.
Don't look at my notes. They're secret.
So I'm trying to not look that.
It's okay. How about you, Josh? What's your name?
So my name is Josh.
Faith.
Josh Faith. Josh Bruce.
That's welcome, Josh. Yeah. Bruce.
And my favorite toothbrush.
Toothbrush color.
My favorite toothbrush color is white.
Ooh.
Because then it's also a scale for how well you've been doing
with
brushing
your
teeth.
So you can see how white your teeth are.
Yeah, it's a good. It's like, you know.
Wow. Okay, you must have very white teeth. Mm. Let's see them.
Yeah.
give us a smile.
Let's focus in there. Let's zoom in, Faith.
Enhance that.
There you go. Pearly whites.
All right. I neglected brushing my teeth for like
me too.
A decent amount of my
childhood.
Yeah.
Adulthood.
Right now.
Is this an expose?
No, that's just reality. It's
okay.
Just
same.
Like that's real.
Oh. One of my cardinal sins is probably like laziness. So.
Okay, we're getting deep. Let's get to the deep questions here.
Let's dive.
I also, as a child, when I was younger,
childhood.
I was, yes. But I had neglected brushing my teeth all the time. And then my orthodontist, before I got braces, he was like, you have to start brushing your teeth or else we're not going to give you braces.
Ooh.
And I was like, all right. So then for the next 3 months, I just had a radical change.
And that
I think
was
that,
a threat.
Honestly, like that could be incorporated into my testimony. That's like when a lot of things changed.
When you started brushing your teeth?
Yeah.
No,
I just started like taking
that.
Life more seriously.
Yeah,
oh, man.
Brushing your teeth, making your bed.
Yeah, still don't do that.
I believe it.
My first question for you guys. Mm-hmm. If you had a wildly successful podcast and you could have anyone on, past or present, so they don't have to be alive currently, who would you have on your show?
Matthew Bentler.
Yeah, this is perfect. I don't have any dreams beyond this reality.
You need higher dreams.
Okay, no, I've always wanted to pick at the brains of good songwriters.
Oh.
Like my favorite songs, and I want to like interview the people that write the music and just like hear the story behind the lyrics.
Cool.
That's what I want to do.
Did you just hear me burp?
A little bit.
Oh my gosh.
It's okay. Don't worry.
So much pressure. I've brushed my nose probably 3 times, and normally I wouldn't know the number of times I've brushed my nose.
But now you're like self.
Every single time it's just like 4, 6.
Whoa.
Let's do a little tally. Yeah. Do you edit this
one? How about you, Josh? Who would you have on?
Who would I have on if I had a wildly successful podcast?
Yeah. Anybody. Like Padre Pio, Taylor Swift, anybody.
Neither of those. For different reasons.
Okay.
Padre Pio spoke Italian.
Oh,
that would
yeah.
be a really hard so conversation.
Like, he probably could understand you.
Subtitles.
Translator.
Yeah. I don't, there's a lot. My mind always goes to like, okay, what's my podcast about? Mm-hmm. And then like, you know.
What's the purpose? Mm-hmm. All those fun questions.
He's stressed about this question.
I would have, you know, I've always thought it'd be funny to like interview St. Joseph and he's just like chilling there. Like,
he's like, I'm not.
Like the video with Pierre where he's just like.
Yeah, that was funny. That is a funny video.
Yeah, that'd be fun. Pick at the brain of St. Joseph.
Yeah, that would be good. I think I would. I don't know. I don't know. I'm sorry.
That's okay.
I feel like you'd be the podcaster that thinks of the title after the tangent. Like you'd just talk for 30 minutes and then you'd come up with the theme. That would be your style of podcast.
And the name of the podcast would be After the Tangent.
Oh. Whoa. Can I come? Yeah. And then we'll have a segment called Music. Faith and Music.
Oh, Faith
and then I'll interview my songwriters.
You hit the table again.
You do that a lot. You're like...
Really?
Yeah.
That's how I express my emotions.
You can be expressive, just not on the table.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying?
Right.
I think if I had a wildly successful podcast, you know who I'd have on?
Who?
Josh.
Oh, okay. That's Jinx. My joke.
You...
That was so... That, it would be fun. It's fun right now.
It's fun. We just need the wildly successful part now. Like and subscribe if you haven't already. Also, a big thank you to our co-missionaries who support us. If you'd like to become co-missionary, you can head to netcanada.ca. But just earlier in the office today, I was hiding behind the wall and Faith walked in. I was like, love. And then I misquoted the meme.
Yeah, you know the...
Explain it to us, Faith.
There's a vine, really old.
Oh, sorry.
There's a vine of this guy saying, why is everyone afraid of love? And then he creeps up onto this... woman at the grocery store and is just like, love! And she's like, oh.
She's like startled. Why is everyone afraid of love? Yeah.
So we did that.
And then I misquoted. I was like, why are you scared of love? Yeah. And you're like, you misquoted it. And I was like, oh I'm sorry. Yep.
Anyway, reel it in.
Reel it in. Okay, let's reel it into the actual, theme of the video podcast. The main theme we're going to be talking about today is what role do youth play in the church? Big topic.
Yep.
Big topic. And the first specific question I have for you guys, this is just like popcorn style, no pressure. How do you see, whoa, let me read this right. How do you?
Sorry, how Faith is trying so hard.
Like, let me take
to not look at the question.
Faith, can you read the first question? Oh. I actually can't read it very well.
This here, one?
Yeah,
it's because it's in italics.
I might also wrote it wrong. So.
Okay, how did you see yourself as a youth in the church growing up? / What role did you see yourself playing in the grand scheme of things?
Okay.
Hmm.
I was reading it wrong because I wasn't reading it past tense. I was like, how do you see yourself as a youth in the church? I'm like, are we youth? Kind of, but...
Okay, how did you see
yourself? Yeah, how did you see yourself? Here, you can live your dream of reading the paper. You can...
Let me just...
Can you just lead the podcast? Yeah, so how did you see yourself when you were a youngin', a youth, in the church?
The image that comes to mind is like, you know... When your parents are like trying to get like make you get ready for church and stuff like that, and it's like, why aren't you dressed yet? Oh my gosh, you can't wear that to church! And just like literally dragging you out the door. I think that's the image that first comes to mind. Like when I was a young, like I would say like probably like 7 or 8 or something like that. It was always just kind of like I was being drugged there, dragged there by my parents. I wasn't being drugged. My parents did not drug me.
You were being dragged to church, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, so they like drag you. It's just like they're dragging you there, and it's kind of like you're. I didn't really feel like I had a faith of my own or.
Her name's Faith.
So
many faith puns.
Sorry. yeah, I didn't really feel like I had a faith of my own or a church of my own. It was just kind of like, this is what my parents make me do, similar to brushing my teeth.
The parallels.
Yeah.
Full
yeah.
circle.
So definitely that was where I was when I was like more of a child. But there came like a point when I started to take a little bit more ownership or be able to just actually explore the church for myself, explore faith for myself.
At what point was that? Like, how old do you think you were when that started happening?
I can very obviously pinpoint it because it was, this is going to feel like us just patting ourselves on the back because it was when Annette to you.
Oh. That's why you got it on
here. That's okay.
Here.
Annette can, okay.
yeah, basically Annette team came to my parish when I was in grade 7. Okay. And when they came there, it's funny, like I don't think we do this that much anymore, but they used to do like these promos for youth nights that would happen just like as an announcement at the end of Mass, and sometimes they would be pretty like lively and rambunctious. Okay. I specifically remember like one time, I don't even remember what the youth night was, but somebody came yelling down the middle aisle of the church, like, and
like the Net team did this?
Yeah, it was a joyful yell though.
Yes.
It wasn't like you trying to be,
none of that bird yelling.
It was, but I remember just being like, what the heck is going on? I just like started going to the youth group, and I don't know why that's what brought me in. Maybe it was just because it was a young person talking about Jesus. And and so started going to youth group, and it got to the point where like my parents were like, where are you going? I'm like, I'm going to church. And I started to actually be more involved in my faith than actually my parents were. Wow. I don't know. That's kind of like how it progressed. And then, yeah.
Cool.
That's awesome. I don't know if that answered the question.
Yeah, yeah.
How did you see yourself?
How did I see myself?
The direct church.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool. How would you feel?
I would say, sorry, I keep looking. I was like the happy-go-lucky youth. I had a community. I was like born into a very charismatic and joyful and fun community. And I just had friends. So I felt very safe and secure. On weekends, I was always going to like an event where my friends were going to be. My parents were very involved as well, so they would go to like household meetings, and I would come because my friends were there. And I had no issues with community living. And I guess I just had no reason to not question, like, what, no reason to question the joy of the Lord. And I think back to my youth days, and it was a good time. And I feel like, so when Josh was saying he encountered the Net team and he encountered like joyful people, I feel like I was those joyful people. And it wasn't because I was trying to evangelize, but I just had that joy, and people were like, ooh, that's fun. So I feel like I was those people, just different time era. And
so even as a kid.
Oh,
like,
yeah. Just a lot of playing and a lot of coming to things that I knew my friends were going to be at, and it was wholesome. Yeah. But no, this is a completely different answer. Never mind.
But that's like amazing to me, because like the only time I was joyful like in church as a kid was at the end of the church, at the end of Mass, when Father Larry would have this like basket full of suckers, and we would just like book it out of the church and be like, "I want a sucker," and that was like, you know, this whole church thing kind of boring, but priest. Like that guy.
He's got the candy.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Yeah. Something that, like, at my church as well, we had a candy machine in the back.
No, you didn't.
A machine.
We did. It was, like, at school attached to
Okay.
Oh, yeah, church. I've been there.
Shout out to Our Lady of Lourdes Parish in Saskatoon. And the candy machine was, like, where all the posse of boys would go and hang out. And, like, there was sometimes. So sometimes you'd be like, Dad, I have to go to the bathroom. And then my dad would just, like, let me go to the bathroom. And I would just go out to the back of the candy machine and just, like, stare in it.
And get
like,
I never brought candy.
I would press the button, like, check under it.
You just admired
it. Change. But then eventually, sometimes, like, there would be, like, a kid that brought money. He brought, like, he's like, my dad, give me a five. And he would buy candy and, like, share Skittles with people.
Wow.
Oh, yeah. In the back during, like, the homily.
Wait, a $5 bill?
That's a lot of money.
Wow, that's intense. Yeah. Like, I did the bathroom trick, too.
Yeah, you gotta go to the bathroom.
Where, as, like, a kid, I would just be, like, always timed it where it was either, like, during the homily or, like, right after receiving – oh, my gosh, I can't believe I did that. Right after receiving communion as a kid, I would just be, like, yeah, I gotta go to the bathroom. And I would just go. I would just, like – walk around and, like, literally just be in the bathroom for an extended amount of time.
You're just like, there's just, like, I just want to get out and be free sort of, like, feeling. Mm-hmm. And even if your friends weren't there, it was, like, it beat being and having to sit in church.
Yeah.
And then it was, like, once I started altar serving, that's when I had something to do in the Mass.
So you couldn't get distracted. Yes.
Yeah.
So that's kind of an interesting point, too, because I feel like when I started to feel like I was more a part of the church, I was, like, going to youth group. Mm-hmm. And at that point, though, I didn't really feel like I had a role in the church as much as it was just, like, okay, I'm a part of something now, mm-hmm. which is cool. Mm-hmm. But then when I remember I was actually downstairs in my basement practicing trombone.
Oh.
Because I was in grade 9. Yeah.
There's my trombone solo.
Nice. The best part is, like, with the trombone, just doing this thing where you, like, you blow and then you go like this because it's like, it's like best sound. But I was practicing trombone in the basement, and my mom and her church music friends were upstairs practicing. Mm-hmm. And at one point, the music leader came downstairs and he was like, would you ever be interested in singing? Like in the band. And I was like, I guess. And honestly, the only reason I said yes is because the leader mm-hmm. of the music ministry was also a leader at the youth group. And mm-hmm. he was, like, my favorite leader, mm-hmm. Mark or Timko, like, who will probably never listen to this, but just, like, great, great guy. And so I was like, the only reason I did it was because of him. And then it's like I started to actually feel like I had a role in the church. And that's mm-hmm. so it's interesting, you starting to altar serve, mm-hmm. like you where you actually were involved in Mass, mm-hmm. that you started to, like, feel mm-hmm. some sense of, like, responsibility.
Yep. And it was with Sam Jean or Sam Jean, as we call him here on Net.
He interviewed me.
He did?
Yeah.
Oh, for Net?
Yeah.
Oh.
Not just in life. He just called me up and interviewed me.
Can I have you on the podcast? You're popular.
No, what?
Okay, sorry. But we were, I was about to say fools and hooligans. We were fooligans.
Ooh, yes. Nice.
With Sam Jean?
Oh, on the altar for my first Mass, I was so nervous I almost threw up before Mass.
Oh, no.
And I was like, I can't be a candlebearer. My mom had to, like, convince me. There was tears before. I was, like, so nervous because I didn't want to be up at the front. And Sam Jean just, like, made it seem so easy, and he was, like, so good about it. But we were also fooligans on the altar. Like, we were, like, our hands into our altar robes and, like, pumping our hearts out. And, like, pretending to, like, oh, maybe that was with Mark O'Reilly.
Do you ever play with the cincher?
Yeah. With a little spin. Like, yeah. We didn't
That's
have
the
them.
Rope.
We had interesting alt. Yeah, investment.
Oh, okay.
Investments.
That's cool. Anyways,
yeah. But it was, like, it was good, though. But then it eventually, like, deepened and just kept altar serving. And
mm-hmm.
So, yeah. But, like, this is a random question. This isn't on the paper, so don't worry. You won't see it there. Like, were you guys, like, existential as kids? Like, did you, like, think about the grand scheme of things in the sense of, like, when, you know, when this priest... This is kind of a weird thought, but it's like, when this priest dies and everybody here is, like, no longer here, who's going to keep things running?
Oh, no.
Did you think about that?
I did not think like that.
Okay.
I was that guy that was like, there's a meme about this. Yeah. When you look at the chandeliers in church and you're like, who's going to die if that falls? Like, you line it up.
I was that guy. Like, oh! Thinking. Yeah, I
thought about that. You know, you look around and you're like, what would happen if?
Yeah.
So you thought about death, but in a different way. It's like if a chandelier randomly fell.
You're thinking about the priest.
I thought about, like, how like, if this priest dies, who's going to give me lollipops on Sunday?
That's easily replaceable.
And then that's when the Lord said, you, will get the lollipops.
Priest, prophet, and king.
I don't know. I wasn't that much of, like, a deep thinker, like, as a kid. Like, did you?
A little bit. Yeah, that's why I was asking.
Wow, I
believe it. Because I was like, who's going to keep this show running?
Aww. You know?
But I didn't think about it too often. But I would say I was a pretty deep thinker.
Mm-hmm.
To a certain level. I didn't get too far. But yeah, you just like wonder about like what's the future, and then mainly the main thing that would come after that is like fear of like, what if I'm the one who's supposed to run? Or like, who's gonna run church, like youth group? I hope it's not me. But then other people like rose to the occasion, and I remember seeing that of like, you know, Pure Witness started doing youth ministry in our church, and like seeing them do that, and then like catching the joy that they had. Shout out to Sean Roach, like in our youth group, and like I remember being like, okay, if there's a team of people and it's not all on you, this is probably possible. But before that, I had like no interest in getting involved aside from just like altar serving. Like, this is the limit. This is the extent of my helpfulness here.
Well, that's interesting.
Yeah,
yeah. Like when I think about that, like, I think about, for me, having started my encounter with Jesus, like, sort of in that grade 7 time when the NET team came to my parish and started up youth ministry. Mm-hmm. So that youth program started up, and then one of the NET members actually ended up becoming the youth minister at my church, and he still is today, which is so cool. Whoa, like, wow. I think he's now the longest running youth minister in the Archdiocese of Toronto.
Probably Canada.
Ray Reitzel. Awesome man. And he became the youth minister there. And so it's kind of just like, oh, well, net team left. Now Ray's here.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And Ray's never left. So but like I did think about especially in like going into high school, and like now it's like there's this junior high youth ministry that I can help with that I like benefited so much from. And so for me, it was just natural. I just like was like, I'm going to start leading this, helping to lead this youth ministry. And I think the same thing will happen when people come out of high school, like come out of our junior high youth program. They're just going to want to help with the high school youth program. And, doesn't always happen that way. Like that is kind of like an idealist mindset, but like for me, it was just kind of, it was very natural for me. And then it was like, when I graduated high school, it was like, okay, well, I'm going to help out at the high school youth group now.
Mm-hmm. So, cool. Wow. Well done for your youth ministers for making that like a natural process.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's cool.
Kind of same in my community. We, you just kind of have that like expectation that, you're next. Like,
next up,
what it literally looks like is you have like a retreat. You're a participant at this retreat.
Mm-hmm.
And then after that camp, there's training for the next camp. And if you're not a participant, you're a staff member. So it's kind of just like the next step of like, oh, I'm going to lead a small group in the next one. And I'm probably going to give a testimony.
Cool.
I'm probably going to be in skits. So yeah, there was always just a like, oh, it's going to happen soon, because that's just the way of life in this community.
Yeah, it's like school. Yeah. It's like you're going to graduate at some
next
point.
Next level. Next step.
Okay, I am listening, but I realize my ringtone is still on.
Oh.
I don't know if you heard that little sound effect.
I think I did.
It was just time. So turning that off, apologizing to everybody. What were you saying?
I said trombone. Solo.
Wait, what?
That's what I heard
like
in the background.
Like,
there's a phone in here. Where's the phone?
Yeah. But what she said was great.
Yes, next. No, it's fine. Next step. I was just affirming that.
Mm-hmm. You kind of had that same sort of mentality of like, next up. Yeah. I'm on deck.
But it was like a safe. It wasn't like a freak out. Like, oh no, it's all on me.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
we were all doing it together.
Mm-hmm.
We were all taking the next step together. I do move my hands a lot. And,
that's cool.
Yep.
That's very healthy to think that way. I had a question and now it's gone. Well, it'll come back soon.
So, but you said that your experience was like, you didn't think of yourself being the next.
I like didn't want to be. I didn't want the responsibility to be bestowed on me because I saw it as like a vacuum almost. Like it's like eventually it's gonna fall on somebody.
Right.
And if I keep altar serving, eventually, people are gonna notice that I'm the one who's helping, and then I'll probably get asked. So I was like afraid of that happening. that also explains why.
That you'll get asked to be a priest. Or?
Maybe.
Oh. That's where the rabbit hole
led yeah, him. Exactly.
Speaking as a kid who never altar served, it doesn't matter if you altar serve in church. Young, like, old ladies are going to ask you, they're going to say that they think you should be a priest.
Oh, yeah.
If you're a young person, young man, preferably, in the pews.
Hot take number one.
If you're a young man in church, then, like, people are just going to be like, oh, you're going to make such a great priest.
Can I read the Bible and get married?
Yeah.
Can't I just have babies and make them priests? That's just what I assume goes on in men when they don't want to be told that they're
going to be kind of, maybe not that direct, but. So what do you see, like, as the future in the church for youth? How do we, here it came back. How do we communicate this to young people that it's like you have a role in the church, but don't be afraid because it's not all going to be on you. Like, yeah. We've talked about our experiences and there's obviously people come from different places. Some people aren't even going to be thinking about that in the sense of like, I have to step up and do something. Not everybody needs to think like that because then everybody would be walking around with a weight on their shoulders. Is there like a certain age range that it's like, this is when we need to start giving more responsibility to people or expecting more or asking more of people?
I have like a million thoughts.
Yes.
Okay. When you said you were saying something, when you started music ministry, you were doing it because of someone. You were doing it because there was an influential role model in your life and you were like.
And I liked to sing.
Yeah, you like to sing.
And you are good at singing.
You're good at singing. But the motivation was like, this person who I look up to is going to be there, so I want to be there. Mm-hmm. And I think it just like, there's always, like you're always attracted to where you don't feel alone. Like you don't feel like you're going to be the only one there.
Right.
Mm.
I think I had that security of like, I'm not going to be alone in it, so it's going to be a joint effort, and it's going to be fun as well. Because, it's not all on me, but what's hard is if no one is thinking like that, everyone's waiting for everyone else. Like, everyone's waiting for the first person, but what if you have to be the first person? But, if you just do it, like, if you just take that... especially influential people, like if you know that you are someone that people follow or that people are attracted to in the most humble way possible, but if you know you have that charism, take that first step and it will, people will come and follow and it will look attractive and it won't look daunting. But it's just hard to convince people to be the first person because... the risk. Like, what if no one follows and it is all on me? Because it happens too. But
have you ever seen that video of the, it's like about the first follower?
Yes.
No. Where there?
That's what I was trying to explain without reference.
This like video of, it's at like an outdoor concert and everybody's kind of listening to the music, but everyone's kind of just like sitting and watching, like they've got their blankets rolled out. It seems like a very nice environment, honestly. But then this one guy in the video just like gets up and starts dancing, and he's dancing wildly, like he's like got, he's like so free, like
his
arms
shirtless
like
as well,
flailing.
Right?
I wasn't gonna mention that part, but it's true.
It's just vulnerable and it's it's wacky.
David before the Lord,
maybe not.
Maybe not. Let's make it pastoral.
But so he's just going wild, and then it's hilarious watching it. It's like this guy's dancing, and then all of a sudden somebody is running towards him, like from out of the frame of the shot, and just like runs towards him and starts dancing with him. Oh. And then all of a sudden, just like 3, 4, 10, 20, until there's like a whole crowd, basically everybody who was originally just like sitting, like started dancing.
Yeah, whoa. Exactly.
You know?
Like,
holy cow.
And that's like the image, I think, that it's like somebody has to be that first one. But how does that happen?
Mm-hmm.
Like for me, Mark like noticed. He was like, oh, Josh, I know that he likes to sing. He's been in like the school musicals.
Mm-hmm.
And he knew that about me because he had a relationship with me from high school youth group.
Mm-hmm.
And he just was bold.
Yep.
And said, like, do you want to be a part of this?
Courage.
And from him asking, and it's like, okay, you know, I'll do it.
Yep.
And I think that's what I see. What was the question again? I think I'm answering it, but
I made it up.
Okay.
Yeah, I don't remember what
like
I said.
What's your message to young people, like, so they don't feel, I guess, afraid, or so they don't feel like it's all on them?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I guess what I was getting to is just like, you need somebody just needs to ask a young person to do something, mm-hmm. because like people, I think that there is sometimes like a negative outlook that culture has on young people, like thinking that like they can't contribute that much. It's like, you know, they're not in the workforce yet or mm-hmm. whatever. So it's like, they're not providing in society. And it's like, no, like, but when it comes to church, like St. Paul says, or like in the letter to Timothy, it's like, say not that you are too young. Right. Mm-hmm. And then like admonishes him to, in his ministry.
Yeah.
You know,
when Tiny Tim became Big Tim.
But that's like, that's it. Like, Mark invited me, even though I was in grade 9,
yep.
and was like, do you want to sing with us?
Yeah.
And I was like, all right, you know. And I would say, actually, there was kind of an effect where one of my buddies who played percussion
mm-hmm.
ended up being like, getting involved,
yeah.
because cool. I was singing, yeah. and then another buddy, like, and so it got to the point where my group of friends were like, it was like I was singing, John was playing guitar, Alex was singing as well, and Mitchell was playing cajon, and it was like only high school mostly high school students in the band.
Yep.
Wow.
So cool.
Empowerment.
So cool.
I think about it as well, like in everyday life. When, for example, there's a party and I get invited to it, and one of my first questions is like, who else is going to be there? Or like, how many people are coming?
Yeah.
And you kind of have to know that you have like a safe place before you get there.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. It happens. That's just our human condition, I guess.
Yeah.
And empowerment, I think, mm-hmm. as well. And it's like this balance of not feeling needed to the point of like it's all on me,
mm-hmm.
but feeling necessary and feeling like what I have to offer is good.
Mm-hmm.
So when he pursued you in your gift of mm-hmm. singing, mm-hmm. like you knew you had that to offer. And mm-hmm. so it's also so important to give people roles in where they feel confidence and where they feel like it's a good thing.
Yeah.
Because if you're going to put a young person in administration and they don't love that,
mm-hmm.
who wants that? You know, like,
nobody.
Yeah.
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 And to be like pursued by like someone that you respect and to be told these things and like mm-hmm. shown love through that and like to be empowered in that way, that's like game changing as a young person. Especially, I think, like, in particularly as a young man, to be told it's like you have what it takes.
Yeah.
That's huge.
Yep.
That's so big. Oh, man.
Yeah. Craig Rochelle, who, like, he does, like, a lot of speaking on, like, leadership, especially within the church.
Mm-hmm.
He says, like, there are four, like, of the most important words in leadership are I notice and you matter. And I think that a lot of young people don't feel noticed and they don't feel like they matter.
Yes.
And so as like a youth minister or as a young adult who's involved in the church, for you to go out of your way to actually say, like, I noticed that you're coming to Mass even when your parents aren't. And that's like, and that's awesome. Like, it's you matter. Like, it's important that you're here. Yeah. And then, like, actually, and then out of that, I notice you matter. Like, inviting them into some sort of responsibility.
Yeah.
You know, being like, we trust you. Like,
yeah,
what it takes. I think another important thing is commitment. Like, mm-hmm. I feel safe when there are committed people, mm-hmm. and it doesn't necessarily have to be me. But I get there. I get to the point of like, okay, I want to commit, but it's my buy-in. Like, it's my decision. But mm-hmm. when you see that people are committed, an example is I'm a supervisor right now. And my net teams are in school ministry. They go to the high school, and they've been trying to have small groups, like to start consistent small groups with these students. Mm-hmm. And they're just not committing. Like, the students aren't saying, no, I am free every Wednesday and I will come.
Yeah.
And it's so hard. Yeah. And something that a tip that I gave the net team is, if you want them to commit, you need to commit. And commit whether they're going to show up or not. So it's not, hey, can you come on Wednesdays? It's, we'll be there on Wednesdays. You can come or you cannot, but we'll be there. Mm-hmm. And that just gives them the freedom to decide, because young people also can't commit, and that's fine.
Yep. But I'm so non-committal.
Yeah. Be the person that commits.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
be okay with rejection.
Yeah. Or they're like over committed to everything else. You know?
Yeah.
Oh man.
Juggling too many things.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And another thing is, like, if a young person has, like, a knack for leadership, or they have, like, a knack for something, you can see that at a younger age usually. Like, and so, like, to develop that early on, it's like, I've noticed, you know, people follow you.
Yeah.
Yep.
Gregory.
Yeah.
Whatever your name is. And, like,
that's my middle name.
Oh, it is.
Josh, I've noticed people follow you. And, like, that is, like, a huge responsibility and, like, a power that you have. And, like, if you use that for the glorification of God, that's going to make huge changes in the church. And, like, it's going to be a beautiful thing. Like, would you want to be a youth leader? Like, to notice and to, like, ask something of somebody like that.
Yeah.
Oh, yep. Man.
I remember doing that sort of thing on my first year of NET. I was on a traveling retreat team. We went across the country and did retreats for young people. And I remember when I would notice that there was a kid who just, like, When they say something and answer a question, like, everybody, like, turns and they're like, oh, Matthew's speaking, you know, or like, and then, and sometimes, like, they use their influence badly. Like, it's like they start, like, talking and stuff during a talk, and then everybody else will start just, like, because it's like they started it. And so what I would do is, like, if I noticed, like, a young person who had that sort of influence, like, I would actually try to talk to them one-on-one and be like, yo, bro, like, did you notice that, like, I don't know if you know this, but I think a lot of your friends look up to you. And a lot of times they'll be like, oh, like, what do you mean?
It's no,
like,
one's ever told them that
before. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. I think a lot of your friends look up to you. And it's like, I notice that, like they kind of are a little bit more quiet when you talk. And then from that, I would be like, and so I need your help with something.
I need your help.
And especially if they're in my small group, I would be like, do you mind, like, trying to answer the question, like that I'm going to ask, like, in next small group? Like, can you just be the first one to answer? And then we'll see how that goes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And sometimes they take it, like, you know, but when they do, it's like, it changes the entire small group.
Yeah.
You know, it's cool. Yeah.
It's real.
It's like Jordan Peterson and lobsters.
Excuse me?
What?
You're a minority here. We don't know what you're talking about.
He talks a lot about lobsters and the hierarchy of humanity and like how the strong lobsters, like.
Yeah.
Yeah, anyways.
Nope, I still haven't.
You should probably finish your thought for the listeners.
Go listen to Jordan Peterson. He can say that again.
Link below.
Lobsters. Next time you see lobsters at the grocery store, think of this.
Get a lobster.
Lobster.
Rock lobster?
Have you ever cooked a lobster?
No, but I've seen it done.
Oh, yeah.
Do they actually cry when you kill them?
A little bit.
Yeah, like but they squeal.
I actually killed the lobster before I put it in the pot. Oh, sometimes people don't, but I was like, I thought.
It's a little more
humane.
Humane to do it. Yeah, it's like just instantaneous. Just put
them. Wait, what's the humane thing? To just chuck them in the boiling water?
No. First, to kill them first.
Yes.
Rather than boiling them alive.
The knife, you just kind of put it right at in the...
The skull? The cranium? The skull,
yeah. And then just like...
Instant. Instant knockout.
You got yourself a lobster dinner.
I want to see it.
Put some butter on that.
Thanks, Jordan Peterson.
Yum.
He taught you how to do that.
Lobster rolls. Lobster rolls are good.
Lobster rolls? What is this?
Just like a lobster roll.
So what happens when you let go of a lobster at the top of a hill?
No, like a roll of bread, and then you put lobster in the bread.
Oh, you kill it.
You know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Wow. Okay. Well, I think we're about at the time limit.
Oh, really?
We just started getting into this.
We just started lobster rolling.
We just started talking about lobster.
Yeah. What is this? But I have one more question.
Okay.
So that was a kind of a bit of a warning. What needs to be done now to ensure that we are building up the kingdom? So with young people, how can we start? What are some practicals moving forward? Because I think we've covered a lot already in the sense of, like, empower people, notice them. What are the four powerful words you said?
I notice you matter.
Oh, yeah.
Say it with me.
I notice
you matter.
Put that
you
didn't,
you didn't oh, start singing. I'm trying to say it with you.
Let's harmonize it.
New Zealand.
I notice you matter. Wow, we can write a song. I'm going to interview myself after I write this song.
That's who I want on my podcast.
Myself.
Me.
I want a clone of me. We'd have so much fun. That's so true.
We'd just be a riot. That's the picture for my podcast. Just me and me doing this to each other.
Yeah. Faith Cube.
What was the question? What was the question?
Okay, sorry.
Oh, yes. What needs to be done now to ensure that we are building up the kingdom?
With so much.
Youth.
With
so much
youth.
Needs to be done.
I added some extra things.
Okay.
Okay.
I notice you matter is one thing.
Yeah, definitely. Those things, like, basically just, like, looking for those young people and, like, actually, like, giving them responsibility. I think, like, that's the takeaway for me.
Bestowing responsibility.
Yeah. Like, when I look back on my journey, it's, like, mm-hmm. Basically adults were asking me to get involved, you know?
Mm.
Like, my, just, like... Whether it was my uncle who was also a youth minister in the Archdiocese of Toronto at the time, like asking me if I wanted to help with a camp, mm-hmm. you know, or Mark asking me if I wanted to be involved with the band, Ray asking me if I would help like give like a testimony or a talk like at youth group, you know, mm-hmm. Give them responsibility and like they might fall. Like they might fall flat on their face and like they might clam up like when you ask them to do a prayer and just like, you know, and like you ask somebody to do a closing prayer and they just kind of stand there like, God, thank you. Thank
Sweat.
You. our Father who art in heaven. But you can go to them and say like, hey, like, I really appreciate you stepping up mm-hmm. and, like, being bold and stuff like that. Yeah. And then it's like, I don't know. I just think.
Yeah, I would agree. Just every human person just wants to be seen.
Mm.
Let them fly.
Just let them be seen.
Every human person.
Sorry, I didn't stay on the microphone. Yeah, they want to be seen.
Yeah. They want to roll.
Yeah.
Like lobsters.
Even just, like. No. Okay. Maybe this isn't the first step, but when you have personal conversion, like when you realize like the Lord wants me. Mm. Yeah. That's also a turning point when they now become like the committed people and the fear is driven out. And I don't know if that's step one. Because I think the conversion definitely happens after they are seeked out and
after pursued.
Trust
has been established.
No, that'd probably be step two. Take that back. Edit that out. Cut that one out.
Yeah, that's a good point that like you don't need to have a conversion first to like start getting involved.
No.
Oftentimes it happens as you're a youth adult. Mm. People have conversions at net training after they've signed
up. True.
Yeah.
It's true. happens. One other thing that came to mind was that I think a lot of times when we think about how, like, catechism and, like, teaching young people about the faith, we do, like, there's a tendency that I've noticed of people just wanting to water things down, of just, like, you know, like, give them a little bit, you know? We don't want to scare them away. Yeah. But, like, at some point, the truth just needs to be proclaimed.
Yep.
Like, and it's, like, young people can take it. Yeah. Like, they can... Like, you know, like, you don't have to beat around the bush necessarily. Like, you can actually just, like, go for it and proclaim the truth to them. Like, let, like, see, like, say it without, like, flowering it up or anything. Like, Jesus loves you, you know? And it's, like, and actually explain how that's possible, like, through through the incarnation, through his death and resurrection.
Yeah.
Like,
and using language, I just, like, want to clarify, like, using language that they understand in the sense of, like, experiences that they've had. It's like, you know what it's like to be loved by your father or your mother, like, instead of being like, Jesus loves you, and, you know, it's anyway.
And they love they love asking the hard questions, and they love trying to challenge you, but that's how they're gonna get the answers.
Totally. Just be honest,
For
sure. I want to teach a catechism class now.
I have, there's this teacher at one of the high schools on one of the teams. He does this thing on Fridays. He's a religion teacher, and he does sauce box.
Sauce box.
And it's basically a whole lesson where the class can write any question they want. Any question. Like, there's no limit. And he will read the question out no matter what it is. But this teacher is so skilled and so good at bringing the conversation back to, like, truth. Yeah, it's so good.
Whoa.
But though, that's where they ask the hard questions, but they get the true answers. I forgot who was saying this. I think it was a staff event, so maybe you were here too. But about what you were saying about, like, just say it as it is. I forgot who was saying this, but they were like, if I went to a Muslim community. I'm there seeking, like, I want to know what their faith is. I want to know the truth of what they believe. So if I show up and they're trying to water it down, that gives me nothing. Like, that does not give me any answers about what their faith says and what their truth is.
Yeah.
I want to hear it as it is. And so when we have people visiting the Catholic Church or coming to Mass, like, we've missed an opportunity if we're watering down the truth. Because they came there.
Who's the benefit?
Knowing what they were getting themselves into.
Yeah.
And then not getting what they got, like, what they wanted. Like, obviously, there's different situations and different
nuances,
people.
And, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So good. Well, I think we're going to close it there.
No.
No.
Just kidding.
One of you can still speak/pray if you guys want to end us off in a prayer.
Oh, he did the eyebrows. It's me. Okay, in the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit, amen. Jesus, we praise and thank you for this opportunity to share stories and to have fun. We thank you for the youth who are in our church, and we just continue to pray for evangelization and for your truth and for the church. Bless our day and bless our followers and our audience. Amen. In the name of the Father, Son, Holy Spirit. Amen.
I see you leading prayer. You matter.
Oh.
Oh.
I matter.
Practical.
You saw it here. Right here.
You saw it here.
Conversion.
There's a line. Oh, it was like so. It was in the book of Ezekiel today in what we were doing staff prayer. But Ezekiel was asking the angel, was it the Lord?
The angel I'm not of proud the Lord declaring quote scripture.
but he says, like, it's like, Lord, how will I prophesy life into these bones? And then the Lord says, oh, you already know. He doesn't says that in old language. He's like, oh, you know it.
You know, boy.
You tell me.
That's what the gangster Bible would say. That would be the translation.
That's Pia's Bible.
Pia or Pierre?
P-R-P-I-A. She refers to God as bro.
Bro.
Like bro.
Yeah. Pia's been on the podcast before.
Yeah.
So, yeah. Anyways, if you'd like to find out more about our ministry, you can head over to netcanada.ca or follow us. Oh, clink. clink. Or follow us on social media at Net Canada. We've got a pretty fire social media. But yeah, thank you guys for coming on the podcast.
You're welcome.
Thank you all for joining us. We'll see you in next week's episode or next, I don't know, whenever the next episode comes out. We'll see you guys next time.
Bye.
Bye.